Hello, so we've looked so far in this series about using longer samples at cut and legato for making sounds interrupt each other or making a sound stick to its step in a pattern. We've also looked at splice and slice for making patterns of bits of sound, bits of longer sound. Well, it works for shorter sounds as well. But this time we're going to look at chop and striate. So these are older than slice and splice, so you might see them used more often. These days I tend to use splice more than anything, I think, but still chop and striate do some special things which you can't really do with slice and splice. So best learning both methods, see which you enjoy. So let's take a nice break. If you just want to play something once, you can just put once, by the way. To play part of this sound, one thing we can do is sort of make begin and end control patterns. These are like effects, but they control when the sound starts and when it ends. So if I put begin 0.75, it'll start playing it three quarters of the way through the sound. And with end of one, which is the default, it'll end at the end of it. So basically, we're asking it to play the last quarter of this breakbeat. If I play that four times, you'll hear it. Yeah, within the cycle. But it's overlapping, it's a bit messy, but we'll sort that out. another thing you can do, so here it's still got begin 0.75 and end of one, but if we set unit to C, that changes the behavior of speed. So normally speed one would mean just play this at the same rate it was recorded at. But if we put unit C, what it actually means is play this at a speed such that the break in this case, will fit the current cycle length perfectly. So now it's playing that quarter and it's lasting exactly a quarter of a cycle as well. So this time, if I play four of them, they'll be really nicely contiguous. It'll be play one quarter and then play the same quarter but exactly after the other one. There's no gap. And if we change the CPS, it's still perfect. So you can do that, but this is really fiddly to work with these parameters by hand. So I never really do that. Instead, I use slice and splice or chop and striate directly, and they do all that, work out all that stuff for you. So here's an example of using chops. This will chop the break into four bits. If I do that on its own first, you can kind of hear it's a bit messy, but once I do the loop at, it'll work out the unit and speed for you so that it fits the CPS perfectly. Again, if I change the CPS, it'll immediately drop the pitch so that it still matches the rate. So it's going slower, and so it'll sound lower in pitch. If I then reverse that, it sounds kind of smooth, but there are actually four bits. You just can't hear the gaps in between them because there aren't any. But if we reverse that, you can hear it's rearranged the four cuts of that break. And if you slow it down by two, then you start to hear the gap between the parts. Let's try that with the different breaks. That's the break 8, and let's try break 9. So what happens if we then put them both together? So it's slowed down by a factor of 2, so it should play both one after the other perfectly. That's quite nice. If I didn't have the slow 2 there, then they'd overlap again. You need to manually put the slow 2 in this case to leave space for both breaks. So that's with Chop. So Chop has got a friend, an older friend actually, called Striate, which it looks the same in terms of the parameters it gets. So this is the number of parts it's chopping it into, and this is the pattern that it's for the sounds which it's chopping. But the behavior is slightly different. So with Chop, if there's 4 bits of break 8 and there's 4 bits of break 9, it'll play them together like this. With Striate, it'll do something similar, but it will do this. It'll interlace them so that it's playing the first one from both breaks, followed by the second part from both breaks, and so on. Let's hear that. So if we increase the striate value, then that will change the feel of it quite a lot, because it'll be taking more, I haven't got enough fingers, but if I had 8 fingers, then I could show that interlacing. There's no limit to the numbers. If you keep going up, then eventually it'll give up, but it's surprisingly efficient. So that's actually doing 128 of each break. You might notice your CPU drift up if you have too many. But you can push it surprisingly far. So let's keep that 4. And we've already done that. So here we've got 2 different breaks, but it's also possible to use the same one multiple times. So here I've got break number 1. I'm playing it 4 times a cycle. And then I'm slowing it down by 4 so that the different parts don't overlap. Need to move my cursor. So it's playing each part 4 times, one after another. I change that to Chop, it would just play the 4 versions one after the other, and it'd be a bit less exciting. But if we interlace those different ones, it's just repeating, and it sounds like it's kind of smearing it. Again, we can. Quite drum and bass there. So that was fun because it was only had 4 bits, so it was you can really hear the repetitions there. And this is what it normally sounds like. Also try the Bev sample. I won't do that because YouTube tends to detect it as a copyright infringement. But that's a lot of fun. You'll have to set the loop back quite high because it's quite a long sample, but you can have a lot of fun with that. Okay, thanks for listening. That's the end of the 3 videos I wanted to do focusing on working with long samples for now. But any questions you've got, please come forward, and see you on the forums. All right, thanks, bye.